Welcome to the Sunday afternoon service. You can come on in and hopefully be able to sing some more people in. We're going to turn number 26 in our books. Number 26, you can stand up and we're going to sing Great Is Thy Faithfulness. We'll sing two different songs, then we'll have the special before the message this afternoon. Number 26, Great Is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness. Thank you.
Amen. We're going to sing one more song before the special, number 220. In your books, number 220, No One Ever Cared for Me Like Jesus. Number 220. Sing it out, verse number one.
I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so strong and true. I would tell you how he changed my life
Get to the chorus. We're going to sing the chorus a cappella. Sing it out together in verse number two.
All my life was full of sin when Jesus found me.
Amen. You may be seated.
Apart from God, a slave to sin, my guilt too much to bear, my heart has found no hope within, and peace gives way to care. Yet now I see your broken form upon dark Calvary. It was my fault that you were torn. You proved your love for me. Now I am yours and you are mine. Oh, precious thought to me, the priceless gift of love divine provides security. The life I owe such mercy could never be enough. But thank you, Lord, for making me the object of your love. With contrite heart, I bow in shame before priceless gift of love divine, provides security, the life I owe, such mercy could never be enough. But thank you, Lord, for making me the object of your love. And when I feel my heart would break for grief within my soul, help me to know there's no mistake, my God is in control. Yet now I feel eternal arms supporting me inside. You are a shade from every harm, you'll never leave my side. Now I am yours and you are mine, oh precious thought to me, the priceless gift of love divine. Provide security, the life I owe, such mercy could never be enough. But thank you, Lord, for making me the object of your love.
Amen. Thank you, ladies. Appreciate that. That's quite an amazing thought, isn't it? But God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Just mind-blowing to think of the love of God for us. Well, we forgot to put in the schedule the children's Bible offering, and we didn't feel like it was right to skip that because the children would be probably a little upset. The deacons who have to count the pennies would probably not be as upset, but so we're going to have the kids come and give their offering here in just a minute. You can prepare yourselves for that, so I'll stall a little bit. If you need a copy of the doctrinal statement, Samuel's doctrinal statement, we do have a few copies left in the back. Some of you have already picked some of those up, and also that was sent out by email if you're on the church email list. You probably got that in your inbox sometime this morning. So our ushers have those in the back if you want to grab one while we're taking the offering. Just a reminder that the children's Bible offering will be going towards National Bible Publishing Month at Bearing Precious Seed. And the good folks out there at Milford, Ohio, have been printing Bibles for many years that they send free of charge to missionaries on the mission field for distribution. And they've targeted four countries this year that they are emphasizing. They'll be printing Bibles and then shipping them. The money that is collected from this offering, both not only our church, but many other churches are giving towards this, will go only towards buying paper for printing those Bibles. And then their ministry absorbs the rest of the costs, the operation of the presses, the shipment, and all that sort of thing. So we encourage you to give generously through your children and trust that God will bless as we have a small part in what God is going to do through printing these Bibles. So Brother Joel's going to play some music and the children can come and give their offering.
Thank you.
All right, that was good.
That makes your day.
It does. It does make your day. Today is Diana Roy's birthday, so if you see her later, you'll want to let her know that you appreciate her and wish her a happy birthday. I'm sure she really wanted me to say that today, make sure that everybody knew it was her birthday, but if you see her afterwards, you'll want to wish her a happy birthday. Some of you went into time warp when I said this morning that we did this a year ago, and maybe the last 6 months have felt like a year. I don't know. We did this 6 months ago with the Goss family, not a year ago. The men, the deacons reminded me that it was just in September when we sent Jeff and Nina. And so it's a great privilege that God gives to us to see men raised up and trained, and then to have the privilege of sending them forth to the work. And I made mention this morning in the Sunday school hour, there is a great, great need for men who are called of God to go and to be working in the mission field. And I think of how to say this. I get calls about churches that are looking for pastors pretty frequently. It's not unusual for me to field calls or emails from churches or pastors that are in need of retiring, and they're looking for a pastor and want to know if I know of anyone that would be a good candidate. We don't just line our guys up and say, okay, you out of here, you out of here, you out of here. But we try to be sensitive to the Lord's leading. All of us on our ministry team here are busy in the work. And so every time that someone leaves, it creates more work for the rest of us. I guess you could say that. Things get shared around and new opportunities to bring fellas on. It's not like, we're twiddling our thumbs and don't have enough to do, so we need to send some guys off. There's plenty to do here in the ministry, and it's important work that's being done. We're thankful for that. At the same time, as a church, we don't ever want to get to the place where we hold on to the guys that God has given to us and say, no one's allowed to go anywhere. You have to stay here. Because many times, I think God is going to place his hand on different men and ask them to go to other places to serve. So when Brother Neesmith, Rick Neesmith, called me back, I guess it was around Thanksgiving time that he called, and he wanted to speak with me. And I've known Brother Neesmith for a number of years. I don't know him really well, but we have a lot of mutual friends, and we've spoken on the phone, and I've met him a couple of times. I've never been to the church that he pastors, but he began to describe to me his situation. He's in need of retiring. His health is starting to fail, and he didn't want to leave the church without a pastor if something were to happen to him. And he just asked, do you have anyone that would be ready? And so my answer always is maybe, and I'll let you know if I come up with any names. And so I prayed about it and felt that it would be good to talk with Samuel and present the opportunity to him. He and I had talked about possibilities for him for the future several times. And so I mentioned it to him, excuse me, and he took some time to pray about it, he and Megan, and then he came back to me and said, I'd really like to talk with Brother Neesmith more about this. And so I called Brother Neesmith and put him in touch with Samuel, and things went from there. They had several conversations, a lot of discussion about doctrine and practical areas of ministry and that sort of thing. And that culminated in, of course, some conversations with at least one of the men of the church, and that culminated with them inviting Samuel to come and preach in view of a call in January. And you know that because Samuel shared that with you, and he went down. They were visiting with Meg's family, and so that's about 6 hours south of there, and they went down on a Sunday, and Samuel preached, and then the church prayed and considered, and it was a unanimous vote. They extended a call to him to come, and that was a wonderful thing, and of course then Samuel accepted that. So here we are, and they're getting ready to move. They loaded their truck Friday and Saturday. Their moving truck is packed up and ready to go. And yeah, it is. It's okay.
He's a good brother. He's
a wonderful brother.
And we're thankful. We're always thankful. But it's also a reminder that when we send people to the work, they're people that we love. But we're always grateful, and we're praying that God will raise up more men to go. More men to be willing to respond to that call, because if you were to take a map of the United States of America and just throw a dart and see where it lands, you have a better chance than not of landing on a spot that needs a good Bible-believing Baptist church, or needs a man to come and pastor a Bible-believing Baptist church that exists but is either without a pastor or at the very end of a man who is aged in the pastorate. When I go to pastors' meetings, the majority of the men in the room are 20 years older than I am. The majority. And I'm often referred to at pastors' meetings as the young pastor. Brethren, I'm not that young anymore. I'm firmly in middle age. There was a time when I was a young pastor, but I'm above 45 now. So my burden is, where are the men that are in their 20s? And their 30s that are ready and willing to go. And as a church, that should be our burden that we carry, for men to go. And so we're grateful. We're grateful for this opportunity. We're thankful for Sam and Meg for the time that they've spent here. And of course, my dad mentioned this morning. Samuel's been here. Other than the time he was in Botswana, he's been here for his entire life. He was born here and has been in this ministry a long time, so we're thankful to have the opportunity to hear his doctrinal statement. Just a word about his doctrinal statement. He's going to come and share that with us. This isn't a trial of him, although, you know, a lot of times, I guess traditionally, that's the way ordination has been viewed, like a trial of the guy who is coming up. We don't bring guys forward for ordination so that we can try them in that moment. We've already taken the time to try and to ask. We're not going to open up to questions from the floor necessarily. However, the benefit of this is, and many of you have mentioned this to me over the years, when a man takes the time to present his entire doctrinal statement at one time in a setting, I mean, obviously, in a brief form, that is so helpful to understand the things, the faith which was once delivered unto the saints, that which we believe, to hear it all in one sitting. And so that's a really helpful thing, and I trust you'll receive it that way. So what we're going to do, Sam and I think Meg is going to come with him. They're going to start by sharing their personal testimonies, and then Sam will take it from there and share his doctrinal statement at that point.
Good afternoon. I will try to keep you all awake as you enter your normal Sunday afternoon nap time, plus food coma from soup and sandwiches. But yeah, I'll go ahead and start with my testimony. Of course, there's many here who've known me my entire life. Some of you ladies probably changed my diapers. Thank you. But it's a blessing to be part of a church that, even though I've grown up here, and you know, Jesus spoke about a prophet is not without honor, save in his own country. And you all are a blessing in that respect. You all are very good to me and to other men who've grown up here, and it's been a blessing to be part of this church. Amen. You know, growing up in a Christian home, I was in pretty much every single service from the time that, even before I was born, till after I was born, and so I was here a lot. And I was under the preaching of the word. And, you know, growing up in a pastor's home, we memorized Bible verses, not only in the home, but also in the Christian school and Sunday school. And, you know, I heard a lot about salvation, about being born again. And I knew that I needed to be born again. I knew that that was something that I needed in order to get to heaven. But I never really knew what that meant as a child. And some of you have been through, I believe it's the Bringing Children to Salvation book. And I believe it's in that book, there's actually a portion of interviews that my dad did with me about salvation and gauging my understanding or lack thereof. And you read through those interviews and it's obvious, you know, though I grew up here, though I understood to some degree what I needed, I had no true understanding of salvation. And so, you know, hearing about hell and heaven and death throughout my years, being saved was something that I was concerned about. I was scared of death. I was scared of going to hell. And so I made many professions. I made, you know, there was many times where I asked God, you know, if I'm not saved, save me. But nothing would ever change. And, you know, during those times, what I was really asking for was just to go to heaven. I didn't want God to have rule over my life. I didn't want him to be my Lord and Savior. I just wanted what I wanted. I wanted to, you know, continue in my sin and get the good part of heaven. I didn't truly want a Savior. And, you know, that continued on for many years until I was about 13 years of age. And in 2003, we had a revival meeting, a week of revival meetings. And during that entire week, I remember being under conviction and thinking about the fact that I knew that I was lost and I knew that I needed to be saved. And towards the end of that week, things came to a head. And we had a teen activity that was supposed to be happening on the Saturday at the end of that week of meetings. And I remember thinking about the fact that I knew I needed to be saved. And there were some things in my life that my parents didn't know about. I had been stealing some change from them. And that was something that they were unaware of. But I knew that if I was going to be saved, I was going to have to give that up. And I knew that I was going to have to make that right. I was going to have to confess that to them and come clean. And so I had this great fear, you know, as a child, that if I did that, if I told my parents what I'd been doing, that I would not be allowed to go to that teen activity. And as a teenager, that's a big thing. At least as a little teenager, anyway. And so I was really concerned about that. And I remember coming to the place where I had to choose. You know, do I want me? Do I want my way? Do I want what I want? Or do I want to give up and let God save me? And I remember coming to that place of turning control over to him. And, you know, growing up in a Christian home, there's a lot of outward things that were controlled. And so a lot of outward things didn't necessarily change. You know, I still had the same parents. I still had to live by the same rules. You know, I was still expected to read my Bible every day. You know, so a lot of that kind of stuff didn't change, but there was definitely an inward change in my life that began. And that's, you know, looking back over the years, that's something that's continued. And I can definitely say that God's Holy Spirit has never left me. He's never let me go. And any time that I try to go down my own path and pursue my sin, he's always there. He's always working. He's always convicting. And he won't let me go. And, you know, it's been a blessing seeing God work in my life. And as I mentioned the other night, I've been here on staff at Lehigh Valley Baptist Church for about 9 years now. And that's a blessing. And of course, you know, I spent just over 2 years working with my parents over in Africa, and that was a blessing as well. And it's been a blessing to be able to be involved in full-time ministry. And, you know, though I don't have a specific day that I can look back at and say, you know at this point in time, God told me you're going to be a preacher. But I can look back over the course of my life and see time and time again where God has given me choices, opportunities to pursue after a career, to pursue after my own goals, or to pursue after Him. And every time He's brought me to that place of making a decision to pursue after Him, to give Him more of my life, to give Him more of my service. And so I definitely would say that God has called me into the ministry. I believe firmly that that's the direction that God has placed upon my life. And of course, just the whole way that this opportunity to go down to Arkansas came about, a lot of the details along with that. I didn't have my name out there looking for a pastorate, but God definitely, He brought it along, and He's just opened the door every single step along the way. And so that's why we're here today. Honey?
So I'll share my testimony with you. I grew up in a Christian home. Same, I was going to church just while I was in the womb. I was in church all the time before I was born. And my grandfather was a pastor at the time, so that's where we were going to church. And I did the same things. I memorized all the verses. I did all my Sunday school papers. I memorized the books of the Bible. I did everything. I was the good little girl. You know, I just did everything I was supposed to do. And when I was about 7 years old, we moved to Texas for about 8 months for my dad's work. And while we were down there, I remember one morning at the breakfast table, my older sister was like, "You need to get saved." And I was like, "Oh yeah, I haven't done that. I need to get saved." And I went and prayed some prayer with my mom. I have no idea. It was just kind of like, yeah, I haven't checked that box. I need to go do that. And there was no repentance, no conviction, absolutely nothing. And so life went on. We moved back to Missouri, and I was around 11 or 12. My grandfather retired from the pastorate, so we moved churches. And when we moved churches, I remember one of the services there, that I felt conviction. I was a little more afraid, like he was talking about, I was more afraid of dying and going to hell. And so I was kind of like, I'm not sure if I'm saved, you know, if I got saved at 7. And so I went and I talked with the pastor after the service. And I remember he didn't really take me to his office. We didn't really, you know, sit down and talk about things. I remember we were in the auditorium and there were kids running around and I was just distracted. And so he had me kneel down there to pray. And I started to pray, and I just remember that I was just distracted. I didn't really know what I was supposed to say. I was just saying words I thought I was supposed to say. And I remember he stopped me in my prayer, which at the time I felt like, oh, wow, you just stopped me in my prayer. But he realized, I think, you know, I wasn't getting it. And he stopped me in my prayer, and nothing really happened from there. I think he talked with my parents, and I really don't know if he was just kind of waiting to see where my heart was, to see if I was going to come back about this, or he thought I was saved and whatever. But I moved past that, kept clinging to, oh, I was saved at 7. And I just had no peace though. And so as the years went on, I was 15. I just kept clinging to that. I was saved at 7. When I would feel that doubt and that fear, I would just go back to that. And when I was 15 years old, some things were happening in the church that shouldn't have been happening. There was things going on in leadership that shouldn't have been happening. And so my dad thought, it's time, we need to move to a different church. The teen group was not a good influence for us at the time. And I remember I was angry. I didn't want to go. I didn't want to leave my friends. But it was good for me. We went to Pastor Jeff Hastings' church, which is where I'm from now. And they're sent out of Brother Jeff Merrick in Knobnostra, Missouri. So they had just only been there for like 2 years. So they were just getting started. It was very small. There was like one other teenager in the church, and I remember feeling like, wow, this is weird. And Pastor Hastings thought it was a good idea for me and my sister and my brother, we were all teenagers, to do the Salvation Bible Basics study together, all three of us. And so I didn't want to do it really, but of course, you know, I didn't really have a choice. My parents thought it was a good idea, so I was doing it. And in that, I think it was about the third or fourth study, is he, where we had the timeline, you know, you had to write down, this was the day that I got saved. And I remember, like, I don't know where to put this on here. And he noticed that about me. And then he said, after that lesson was over, he told each of us, he said, before you come back for the next lesson, he said, each of you need to come to the office and talk to me and Mrs. Hastings about the day you got saved. Tell us your testimony, pretty much. And I remember being like, oh, great. I'm already struggling with this, and I don't really want to do this. I think it was the same day I marched in his office, and I'm like, all right, I'm struggling with this. I want to get this settled right now. And, of course, he opens the Bible, and he brings me to the verses that I knew, I grew up with. I believe he brought me to the verse what said, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then he asked me, he said, do you believe you're lost? And I remember I couldn't admit that. I was like, well, I do all these good things. Because in my mind, if you're lost, you know, you're the horrible, wicked person who does all the bad things. But if you're, you know, saved, you do all the good stuff. And I felt like I did all the good stuff. So I could not admit, yes, I'm lost. So he just closed the Bible up, and he's like, well, we'll pray about it. He didn't want me, you know, force any prayer on me or anything. He's like, let's just go home and pray about it. And so those next 3 days were the most miserable days of my life. That was a Sunday. And so I remember I was doing the same prayers he was talking about. I was like, Lord, if I'm not saved, save me. I was just miserable. I could not get it off my mind. I was scared every time I went to bed. It was miserable. So when Wednesday rolled around, I remember that I have no idea what he preached, but I knew he had to hurry up and get done because I had to go talk to him. And so right after the message, I made a beeline for him, and I talked to him, and he took me back into the office, pulled open the Bible, same scripture, same question. Do you believe that you're lost? And I remember I broke down in tears, and I was like, I have to be lost. I was like, I am so miserable. I have to be lost. And we knelt down to pray, and I remember being so terrified. It's like, I've done this, in my mind, I've done this twice before. I really don't want to mess this up again. And I remember I grabbed Mrs. Hastings' hand, and I said, can you help me? And she told me, she said, you can't mess it up. It has to be from your heart. And as soon as she said that, it was like a light bulb went off in my head. It has to be from my heart. And I was like, well, God knows my heart. And, you know, he knows that I'm not coming flippantly. I'm coming sincerely. I want to do this right. I want to do what he wants me to do. And so from there, I knew what I needed to do. I don't remember the whole prayer I prayed, but I know I asked him to forgive me of my sins. I admitted I was a sinner. I knew I was a sinner, and I knew that I believed in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He was the only way to heaven. And I asked him to forgive me of my sins and to come into my heart and save me. And after that, I did not have the euphoric, glorious feeling of burden lifted and I feel wonderful. Actually, I doubted immediately. I was like, oh, I don't feel any different. I don't feel saved. And Pastor brought me to, you know, for all whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But for about a month, I really struggled and I really doubted, because I kept thinking, well, I didn't say these exact words. Did I, you know, I should have said all these words so perfectly. Did I have enough faith? And I wore poor Mrs. Hastings out talking to her over and over again over that past month. And finally, Pastor Hastings just set me down, and he's like, it's not your faith that saved you. It's Christ that saved you. It's not that how much faith, did I have enough? No, I had faith. Yes, it was there. It was present. I had faith. And then he reminded me, it's not based on your feelings. It's based on the facts of what you've done. It doesn't matter. Our feelings are up and down. We can't trust them. So if those things were in place, the repentance, the faith that was needed, if those things were there, then I was saved. And from then on, I had the peace. And I remember, you know, God, like he talked about, God has worked in my life. He doesn't let me get away with sin. He has answered prayers, and I can just see him working in my life. And us going to Arkansas is one of those things. We've been praying for several years, knowing that the Lord was going to take us somewhere. We just didn't know where. We honestly thought it was Africa for a very long time. But I had no idea it was going to be Arkansas. I was totally surprise, but you could just see how God worked everything along the way. We know this is God's will. I'm excited to go with Sam and to do this. And I'm sad to leave you. I'm sad to leave you guys, because I'm going to miss you a lot. You all have welcomed me here. I know I've only been here for about 5 years, but you all have made me feel very welcome in your family, and I'm really going to miss you a lot. But I'm glad we have phones. We'll stay in touch, and for sure, but that's my testimony.
Bless you.
All right, let's go ahead and get into the doctrinal statement here then. Although I did have one verse I wanted to look at first. Galatians chapter number 1. And my doctrinal statement is nothing new. It's partly plagiarized. But the doctrinal positions that I hold and that the men of this church hold and have held, you know, if you compare my doctrinal statement with that of Brother Goss or Brother Thomas or Pastor Chris or Pastor Roland or even of my dad, you'll find them to be very similar. Maybe some changes in wording, but essentially, doctrinally, they're the same. And, you know, we believe that our doctrine, the things that we hold to, aren't just based on our opinions. They're not based on what is popular in the day, what is easy or fun to hold to. You know, sometimes the doctrinal positions that we hold are divisive, and, you know, people don't necessarily like them. And it would be easier, it would draw a larger crowd to hold different doctrinal positions sometimes. But we believe that you can look in the Word of God and that you can look at our Baptist forefathers going all the way back to Jesus Christ. And that if you search and you look in their writings, you'll find the same doctrinal positions that have been held. And they've been handed down to us not, you know, by our imaginations or by church tradition, but from Jesus Christ himself and from the Word of God. And here in Galatians chapter number 1, the Apostle Paul is speaking. In verse number 6, he says, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. And so the Apostle Paul was saying, you know, even if an angel comes down from heaven and present, you know, comes and says, well, here's a new doctrine. He says, don't listen to it. He says, the things that we're teaching to you, the things that we're preaching, they came from Jesus Christ. And you can look at the rest of the verses there in chapter 1 of Galatians. And the Apostle Paul says just that, that he received, verse number 12, he didn't receive it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. And so the things that we believe, the things that are in my doctrinal statement here today, they come from the Word of God. And if anyone ever stands up in this pulpit and says something differently, that should be a big red flag. And that should really cause you to question. And, you know, if any of the men that are sent out from this church ever stand up and preach something differently, that would be a serious problem. So this is my doctrinal statement. Let's go ahead and get into it. Page number 1, concerning the Holy Scriptures. I believe that the Bible, all 66 books of the Old and New Testament, was given by supernatural, verbal, plenary inspiration of God, that it's completely pure and true without any mixture of error or mistakes. I believe that the same Bible has been perfectly preserved for our use today by the supernatural working of God. Pastor Roland spoke about that a little bit this morning, about the fact that through the ages, there have been men, there have been kingdoms, there's been rulers who have tried to eradicate the Scriptures. They've tried to erase the Bible. They've tried to keep it out of the hands of men. But yet, God promised that His Word would remain. He promised that He would preserve it. I believe that the Bible is inspired, that all of the words in our Bible are inspired by God. They're God-breathed. That inspiration is verbal. That every word of the Bible is important. It's necessary and inspired by God. There's no, I think it's brother, his name just flew out of my mind. Fryman, who liked to say that God's not in the business of idle chit-chat. The words of God in the scripture, they're not just meaningless words. They're put there on purpose. Plenary, that this inspiration extends to every part of the Bible and every theme which it develops. There are no parts of the Bible which are uninspired or less inspired than others. And that this work of inspiration, you know, God speaking through these men, it didn't violate their personalities. You can see that some in the writings of the Apostle Paul, and we can distinguish the writings of some of these different men and their personal style, but yet the things that they were writing down, the things that they were recording, were the exact words that God breathed. The Bible is preserved, that God has promised to keep his word without error and in every generation. It's my belief that God has used his people, first the nation of Israel, and then his New Testament churches in this work of recognizing true scriptures and in the subsequent work of preservation. Importantly, I believe that the preserved word of God can be found today in the Hebrew Masoretic text of the Old Testament and the Greek Textus Receptus of the New Testament. And that is becoming a more hotly contested issue as the days go on. Furthermore, I believe that the English King James Version is the perfectly preserved and inspired word of God to those of us today who speak the English language. God's word is reliable. It's without error. It's profitable in every way. Spoke about that this morning, for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction of righteousness. And the things that you and I need for our spiritual life, they're found in the Word of God. They're not found in men, they're not found in the writings of men, but rather they're found in the Word of God. I believe that God's Word is intended by its author to be applied to my personal daily life, that we're not just to be hearers of the Word, but that we are actually to be doers of the Word as well. An interpretation, I hold to a historical, grammatical, and literal interpretation of the Bible. That it's not something that you have to come to and think, oh, well, you know, I've got to interpret this through some weird lens or I've got to twist it to get some meaning out of it. But rather, there's historical, grammatical, and literal interpretation of the Bible. I believe that, you know, it's impossible for lost folks, those who do not have the Holy Spirit dwelling within them, to fully comprehend and understand the Word of God. I think that they can come and maybe get some benefit from it, but to truly understand the Scriptures is a work of the Holy Spirit. And finally, I believe that the Bible is the final rule of all matters pertaining to our faith and our practice in life. Next section there, concerning the nature of God. I believe in the one and only true God who reveals himself to us in his Word, the Bible. You know, I think that's really the purpose of God's word. It's his love letter to us. It's his revelation of himself to us. It's his desire that you and I would come to know him, that we would come to see his love, that we would come to see ourselves and our sin and our rebellion and know how we can have a relationship with him. You know, it's interesting. God's existence, God doesn't argue for his existence. But rather, Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You know, he doesn't come with some big argument about how we should or why we should believe that he exists. But rather, it's just stated. It's assumed that God does exist. I think, you know, there's some reasonable arguments that we can look at for his existence, the universal concept that humans have of there being a supreme being throughout all cultures and throughout all times. There's the cosmological arguments as we can look outside at creation, at the cosmos that argues for a designer. And you know, you've heard the tongue-in-cheek story about walking down, you know, I was walking down the street the other day and there was an explosion at the Rolex factory. And you know, this beautiful Rolex Submariner came flying out of the explosion and landed on my wrist and I looked down and it was keeping time. And you say, well, there's absolutely no possibility that that would happen unless it was already a created Rolex that someone had formed. They'd put all the pieces together. They'd gotten it all dialed in so that it was keeping time, right? You would assume, you look at the watch on your wrist, there's a designer, there's someone who made it. Same thing with the cosmos. And yet, our world is so much more intricate and so much larger. And you know what this James Webb Space Telescope that they've got out there now? They're discovering more and more galaxies, and scientists keep saying, those shouldn't exist. But yet they do. Interesting, okay? The cosmological arguments, there's teleological arguments, the orderliness of creation, anthropological arguments, the moral, intellectual, and emotional components of mankind point to a creator. Okay, then there's the scriptural declarations of his existence. We spoke about how the scriptures do not seek to prove the existence of God, but rather state it. It's assumed. Psalm 14:1, the fool hath said in his heart that there is no God. And 1 Corinthians 8:6, but to us there is but one God, the Father of whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Some of the attributes and nature of God, we'll just touch on these briefly. God is a spirit. He's not limited by physical substance, and he's not able to be comprehended by all of our five physical senses. He's a trinity. God is three persons in one, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Each of these three persons in the Godhead are equal in ability, divinity, even while they are distinct. God is infinite. He's not bound by the limits of finite matter. He has no restrictions of time or space. He's the one who created it. God is self-existent. He exists by his own power. He's not dependent on you or me or anything else. God is holy. The Bible describes him as thrice holy. The angels around the throne, they cry out constantly, God is holy, holy, holy. He has no trace of sin or imperfection. You know, there's verses along with all of these. We really don't have time today to visit all of them. But if you ever want to study it out, these are good passages. God is truth. There is no possibility of deceit or falsity in God. Everything that he says and does is true, unlike you and me. God is love, and the ultimate expression and really the understanding of what love is only known and described in God and his extension of love to you and me. God is immutable. It's not possible for God to change. God is the same today for you and me as he was for Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God is an eternal God. He's without beginning and without end. He's omniscient. He has full knowledge of all things. He's omnipresent. He's present everywhere with his entire being. He is omnipotent. God has all power and ability to do anything which does not violate his nature. He's faithful. God will not change his character, and he is always faithful to his promises. Which, you know, what a blessing. That God doesn't look at me and my failures and my lack of faithfulness to him and say, you know what? I changed my mind. I'm going to remove salvation. I'm going to do away with eternal security. That guy's no longer saved. That's a blessing that God is faithful. He doesn't change. That's a blessing to all of us. He's incomprehensible. It's impossible for anyone but God to completely comprehend or explain who God is. And you and I are completely dependent upon God's revelation of himself for our understanding of his nature. And you know, if you really think about it, you would want nothing less from God. If you could take God and define him and put him in a box, he would cease to be God. God is incomprehensible. But yet, God is personal. God is concerned with a personal relationship with mankind. He is the initiator of that relationship and has provided all that is necessary so that you and I can have fellowship with him. Concerning Jesus Christ, I believe that Jesus is God in the flesh, come to this earth to become the Redeemer of man. The person of Christ, his deity. Jesus Christ is fully God, eternal in his existence, and is declared as the Son of God in the Scriptures. And that term, Son of God, does not somehow denote that he's lesser or less important or that he wasn't God, but rather, you know, you really research that term, the Son of God. That's placing him as equal with God, which is why when he said that in the Gospels, the Jews, they picked up stones to stone him. And in fact, the commentary says just as much, that he was placing himself as equal with God in every way. The scriptures fully attest to the fact that Jesus Christ is God. This truth is seen in the prophecies concerning the Messiah, which were fulfilled by Jesus Christ, as well as in the statements of Jesus himself. And his deity is demonstrated by his miraculous demonstration of divine power during his earthly ministries. You know, what my dad was talking about this morning. They were focused on the bread. They missed the miracles. They were so captivated by the fact that, poof, there was bread and they could eat it, that they missed the fact, wait a second, where did that bread come from? How is that guy able to do that? The deity of Christ, the humanity of Christ. Though Jesus Christ was fully God, Jesus was born of a virgin, and he, you know, this was by the miraculous power of the Holy Spirit and in fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy. This virgin birth guarantees that while he is fully human, he is without the hindrance of a sin nature that comes from an earthly father. Jesus Christ identified with us in every way, experiencing sorrow, joy, hunger, fullness, pain, relief, as well as temptation to sin. However, in his life, through all of this, Jesus Christ never once sinned. In no way did the humanity of Christ detract from his deity. In every way, Jesus is fully God and fully man. His two natures are so completely joined that he may properly be called the fullness of the Godhead bodily. The work of Jesus Christ, in Colossians 1, 16 through 17, we find that Jesus Christ is the creator and the sustainer of all that is. By him, all things consist. The work of Jesus as the Redeemer, his redemption of mankind. He redeemed us by his death. And his death, of course, was a substitutionary death for us. He freely gave his life. No man was able to take it. And his death was something that was prophesied of in the Old Testament. The disciples finally got that. They finally put two and two together. It took them a little while. Jesus talking about that, Jesus telling them, guys, I'm going to the cross. And it wasn't really until after he died. And they're like, oh, yeah, that was written about in the Old Testament. So he redeemed us by his death as the perfect sacrifice, once and for all, satisfying the demands of God. Jesus fully satisfied God's demand for the punishment of sin. He redeems us by his blood, which was shed on the cross of Calvary, a sinless blood, without which there could be no remission of sins. And he redeems us by his resurrection. You know, Jesus didn't stay in the grave, but yet 3 days later he arose by divine power, showing once and for all that he was God. Jesus also works for us in intercession. We find that in the book of Hebrews, chapter 7, verse number 25, speaks about how Jesus Christ, from his position of authority at the right hand of God the Father, is now interceding for you and for me. That's pretty cool. He's our advocate, our lawyer, at the right hand of God, saying, no, that one's been paid for. The return of Christ, the rapture of the saints, is an event wherein Christ will call up his saints on the earth to meet him in the air. Believe that the rapture is imminent and that nothing remains to be completed in Bible prophecy which would hinder the rapture from taking place even now. At the end of the 7 years of tribulation, Jesus Christ will be revealed from heaven as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's at that point that he will then set his foot upon the earth, taking vengeance upon his enemies and establishing his earthly kingdom, which will reign for 1,000 years. Concerning the Holy Spirit, I believe in the deity and personality of the Holy Spirit of God. I believe that he is equal with the Father and Son, having the same divine nature. We see his nature, his deity. The Holy Spirit is God. There's many verses there that speak to that, that he is not less than the Father or the Son, but that he is equal to them. The personality of the Holy Spirit, I believe that he has a personality and is a personal being. He's not just an influence or a force, and he's described in the scriptures as speaking in Revelation 2:7, forbidding in Acts 16:6 through 7. The Holy Spirit's described as teaching in John 14, verse 26, praying, calling, having emotions, intelligence, a mind, and a will. The Holy Spirit is important in his works, first of all, relating to the world. The Holy Spirit was active in the work of creation. In Genesis 1:1, it speaks about God talking amongst himself. He's described as reproving the world in John 16:8, restraining the influence of Satan in 2 Thessalonians 2:7, which is part of what will make, you know, the period of tribulation so terrifying, because the restraining force of the Holy Spirit at that point will be removed. I was there somewhere. I lost my spot. Bearing witness to the gospel in John 14, 26 and 27. The Holy Spirit bears witness to the gospel. And being an agent of the new birth in John 3, 3 through 6, Jesus' conversation there with Nicodemus. Relating to the believers, the Holy Spirit is critical to you and I as believers. The Holy Spirit of God indwells the believer from the moment of salvation. And from that moment, it is possible for the believer to grieve or quench the Holy Spirit. But it's God's will for the believer to be filled with the Holy Spirit. His ministry is that of sealing God's children, guiding the believer into all truth, and teaching him. He also illuminates the understanding of the believer so that he might comprehend the Word of God and brings forth spiritual fruit in the believer. And if you've been saved for any length of time, you've experienced that. Reading through his Word and a passage that you've read countless times, all of a sudden God will apply to your heart and say, yep, that, I'm speaking to you. The work of the Holy Spirit. He gives assurance to believers and brings comfort and help to the believers. Jesus Christ referred to him as the Comforter. The baptism of the Holy Ghost, which was spoken of in Acts 1:5, was a one-time event which occurred on the day of Pentecost, when the believers at the Church of Jerusalem were empowered by the Holy Spirit in a visible and powerful way. And that's not something that you and I are to seek after today. The Holy Spirit resides in us at the moment of salvation, and we don't experience a baptism of the Holy Spirit like they did in the book of Acts. Relating to the Scriptures, the Holy Spirit is the author of the Scriptures. We spoke about that a little earlier. Relating to the Son, the conception of Jesus Christ took place by the power of the Holy Spirit. During his earthly life and ministry, Jesus received the anointing of the Holy Spirit, was led of the Holy Spirit into the wilderness, and the offering of Jesus was through the Holy Spirit, and his resurrection was by the Holy Spirit. Today, it is the ministry of the Holy Spirit to call attention to the Son. And you know, that's a very key truth to hone in on, because there's many that teach, you know, the filling of the Spirit will lead you to do all kinds of incredible things, you know, pray in different languages and do miracles, right? But all of these guys that do that kind of stuff, they're drawing attention to themselves. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is to call attention to the Son, to Jesus Christ. Regarding spiritual gifts, there are spiritual gifts from the Holy Spirit which are given to every true believer, so that they might fulfill the purpose of God for their life and edify the body of Christ. Some of these gifts were temporary gifts and were for the purpose of giving a sign and validating the ministry of the apostles until the time of the completion of God's revelation, at which time these gifts ceased. These gifts are the gift of the apostle, the prophet, tongues, healings, knowledge, and prophecy. Of course, there's supporting scripture passages there if you have any questions about that. Others of these gifts are still seen in their operation today and are for the purpose of bringing edification to the church. Those gifts are the gift of the pastor-teacher, the evangelist, ministry, teaching, exhorting, giving, ruling, mercy, wisdom, faith, and helps. Section number 5 there, concerning man. Y'all still awake? I believe that man is the most spectacular creature of all the creation of God, that he was created in the image of God in a perfect state of happiness and contentment. But through Adam's choice to rebel against the good law of God, Adam received upon himself the curse of sin and death. Because of that, sin is passed unto all men. And you and I, today, we experience the pain, the death that comes from sin. Man's creation in the image of God, man was created by a special act of divine creation on the sixth day. He was made in the likeness and image of God, which image still abides in man, though it is blemished by the marks of sin. This is an important one that I added in here today. Man was created with only two genders. In Genesis 1:27, we find that God created him male and female. That's it. Man was created by God in a position of innocence, with the ability to choose to be free from sin. Man was created by God with three distinct parts, body, soul, and spirit. And in this way, man bears a likeness to God, who is a triune being, a Trinity. Man was created by God for the purpose of bringing glory and honor to his majestic name. Any man or woman who departs from this purpose will lack the fulfillment that God desires for them to enjoy. And so for you and I, if you seek fulfillment, if you seek purpose in this life, fulfill the purpose that God has for you. That's where you'll find joy and fulfillment, nowhere else. Man has an eternal soul, having a distinct beginning but no ending. Every man will exist forever, either in heaven or in hell. Man's fall in the Garden of Eden, Adam chose to sin willfully against the clear command of God after his wife was deceived. God allowed this temptation to test their obedience to him, but the choice to sin was fully Adam's. It was not forced upon him. Because Adam chose to rebel against the commandment of God, he has brought upon all of his descendants the curse of sin and of death, both physical and spiritual. Because of this curse of sin and the nature thus inherited from Adam, every person born into this world is bequeathed by their natural inheritance a predisposition for sin. Rather than basically good nature that some people like to talk about, every man is fallen in his nature and sinful and is in dire need of one, the only one, to save him from the consequences of his sinful choices. Concerning sin, the creation of God that he originally made was perfect and without any blemish. When Lucifer was lifted up in pride to rebel against the authority of God whom he served, sin was introduced into the universe for the very first time. As a result, Satan, Lucifer in his fallen form, tempted Adam and Eve to rebel against God. And when Adam made his choice to do so, sin tainted all of the good creation of God. The sin of mankind is a stench in the nostrils of God and must be judged by him as demanded by his holy nature. The definition of sin, sin is defined as missing the mark of perfection which God demands. Sin is also the willful transgression of the law of God. There are many terms which are used in the Bible to describe sin in its various forms. Iniquity, which is kind of the attitude of the heart. Rebellion, which is a very blatant outward attitude of sin. Fault, which is more like a fault. Being lawless, saying, no, I won't be ruled by that law. And disobedience, knowing the clear commands of God and still stepping across the line. The origin of sin, we talked about this a little bit in the beginning. Lucifer introduced sin into the universe when he lifted his heart up in pride against the authority of God. He led a host of the heavenly angels in rebellion against God, and they were cast out of heaven. Satan tempted man to disobey the command of God, saying, yea, hath God said. And sin is now passed down to all men in the form of a sinful nature, which is predisposed towards sin, that nature that each one of us has. Sin is not an eternal force, but sin is more than just the weakness of man's flesh. It is rebellion against God's law. Sin is a universal problem of man. Sin is completely contrary to the nature and character of God, who is completely without sin. Sin is destructive to man, but he is strongly drawn by his own nature to sin. Have you ever experienced that in your own life? It's destructive, but yet you're still drawn to it. Sin binds man to his true, blinds man to his true condition before God. And the source and great tempter to sin is ultimately the devil. Then, of course, the consequences of sin. There's the consequences upon creation. The whole of creation groans and travails under the curse of man's sin, waiting for the time when God will make everything new and right again. The consequences of sin upon man. Because of sin, death has come upon man, and every man can anticipate that his body will deteriorate through the process of illness, old age, and trauma until the time of death. And some of us experience that more than others. Get out of bed this morning and experience the consequences of sin. Also, because of sin, man has received spiritual death, which is to say that he is cut off from fellowship with God and will eventually be separated forever from God in the punishing fires of hell, unless his state is changed by the process of the new birth. For those who turn aside from the grace of God and refuse the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, they will immediately experience punishment in the fires of hell at the point of physical death. This hell is a literal place of torment, fire, and darkness. At the time of the great white throne judgment, those who are in hell will stand before the judge of all the earth, and will be justly condemned for their rebellion against him. As a result of this judgment, they will be cast into the lake of fire to be tormented forever. Upon Satan and his angels, the pride and rebellion of Satan and his followers has transformed them from angels that once ministered to and worshiped the holy God to the most despicable creatures of all that is. One day, Satan and all of his fallen angels will be cast by God into the lake of fire to be tormented forever. Section number 7, concerning salvation. I believe that salvation from sin and its penalty is freely offered only by the grace of God through the substitutionary sacrifice of Jesus Christ upon the cross. I believe that this salvation is offered to every person who will repent of their sins and turn to God in faith, trusting only in the redemption provided through the blood of Jesus Christ. And I also believe that once this gift of salvation is received, there's no fear of ever losing that salvation. Amen. The guarantee of God is for eternal life. The need of salvation, salvation is necessary because of man's violation of God's holy law. There's a universal need of salvation because every man since Adam has a nature of sin and has made choices for sin. Without salvation that's offered through Christ, the just consequence is punishment in hell. The provision of salvation, salvation's been provided because of God in his supernatural foreknowledge, whereby he anticipated the fall of man and made preparation to atone. The only possibility of salvation from sin is through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the only remission there is for sin. Only those who repent of their sin and put their faith in Jesus Christ alone for salvation can have this covering of sin applied to their account. Repentance is the response of an individual who is sorrowful over their sin, which compels them to change their mind concerning that sin and turn away from sin and to God. The fruit of genuine repentance is a changed life. The result of repentance is a compelling to trust fully in the only solution to the sin problem of mankind. This response of faith in Christ is birthed because of the hearing of God's word and results in complete trust to Jesus Christ alone as the payment for sin. The result of faith, of genuine faith, is a changed life. There are some effects of salvation. When an individual is genuinely saved, it's promised that they will become a new creature in Jesus Christ. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. In salvation, we are delivered from the penalty of sin, the power of sin, and one day in the future, we'll be delivered from the very presence of sin. The eternal security of salvation. Salvation occurs one time in the life of an individual who will never need to be, and it will never need to be repeated. Salvation, once received, can never be lost. The seal which has been given to assure us of the eternal nature of this salvation, the earnest of the down payment, is the Holy Spirit. Speaking of the freeness of salvation, the Bible in no way teaches that God has chosen some individuals for salvation while he has chosen others for reprobation. Salvation is freely offered to all men, and it is the duty of every man to obey the command of God to repent and believe the gospel. God in his foreknowledge always has known who will believe the gospel and who will reject. However, this foreknowledge does not in any way limit the ability of man to choose freely for or against Christ. God invites all men, yea, commands all men, to repent of their sin and believe the gospel. The blood of Jesus Christ was shed for the whole world, the sins of the whole world, and provides sufficient payment and covering for every man. The decision of whether to refuse or receive this payment of Jesus Christ for one's sins is left in the hands of each individual. Those who refuse this payment will pay for their sins themselves the only way they can, in judgment. Those who receive this payment will enjoy the benefits of having their sins forgiven and the enjoyment of eternal life in heaven. When the Bible speaks of predestination, it refers to the intention of God for every believer to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. Section number 8, concerning angels and fallen beings. I believe that there exists by the creating hand of God certain angelic beings whose original intent was to worship God in his holiness. These beings are innumerable and powerful. By the rebellion of Lucifer and his subsequent fall from glory, one third of these angelic beings became fallen and depraved in their following of his example. There remains two thirds of the original number of created angels who are loyal to God and his plan and purposes. These angels continue in the service of God and are ministering spirits to believers. Their nature, in their original state, these angels were created by God as moral beings, having personality and immortality. And they were created exclusively for the purpose of bringing worship, honor, and praise to the name of God. Angels are spiritual creatures. They're created. They're without number. They have personality. They were created in a perfect state. They're immortal, and they cannot procreate. The ministers of God, the ministry of God's angels, we see the ministry of them to the Lord Jesus Christ. We see that the birth of Christ was announced by angels. Jesus was protected by angels as a baby. And Jesus was strengthened after his temptation by angels. And the resurrection of Christ was also announced by angels. They minister also to believers. They're responsible. They protect God's children. They're responsible to minister to believers. They can encourage during times of difficulty and danger, and they minister to believers at the time of death as well. Their responsibilities to the nations. Angels are involved in matters concerning physical nations, and one day they will be the ministers of judgment upon the nations. And their responsibilities to the unsaved. Sometimes angels bring judgment upon unbelievers, and they will be the reapers who gather the unsaved for the judgment. Concerning the fall of Lucifer, I believe that Satan was once Lucifer, the anointed cherub who was created by God for the purpose of bringing praise and worship to the name of the holy God. He existed in such a holy state until the time that he was lifted up in pride and rose up in rebellion against the authority of God. In this rebellion, Lucifer was defiled by sin and led away one third of the heavenly host who rebelled with him. Now this fallen angel is known as Satan, and he is the powerful prince of the power of the air, working wickedness in this world. However, his days are numbered, and his defeat has already been secured, so that he will one day be banished to the lake of fire. Satan fell from his created state through his own choice, as well as the angels that followed him. All of these angels, these fallen angels, have been condemned for their rebellious choice, and they have no opportunity of repentance or redemption. Some of these fallen angels are now bound, and others are free to do the wicked works of Satan in this world. Satan is the father of and originator of lies and sin. In this age, Satan is referred to by Scripture as the god, little g, of this world, and is busy blinding the eyes of men lest they should see the light of the glorious gospel. Satan is the adversary of God's people, and he seeks to destroy and devour those who love God. It's possible for God's people to resist Satan through the power of Christ. And one day, Satan and all of his fallen angels will be judged. The work of the fallen angels. Demons are the fallen angels who followed Lucifer in his rebellion. These spirits are now engaged in the aid of Satan's design to derail and disrupt the plan and purposes of God. It's possible for them to possess humans and animals, as we find in Scripture. Though it's not possible for demons to possess a believer, it is possible for them to oppress and bring temptations upon them. Demonic spirits seek to confuse through the introduction of false doctrines. It's possible for demons also to afflict human beings with diseases and mental sicknesses. Concerning the church, in section number 9 here, I believe we're getting fairly close to being done. I believe that the New Testament church is a local assembly of scripturally baptized believers who are covenanted together and organized for the purpose of bringing glory to God through the execution of the Great Commission. I believe that the first New Testament church was established by the Lord Jesus Christ himself during his earthly ministry. And I believe that to a New Testament church, God has given the privilege and responsibility of administering the ordinances and establishing other churches. I believe that the officers given to the church are those of the pastors and the deacons, and the qualifications and functions of these offices are defined in scriptures for us. The nature of the Lord's church, the New Testament church, is a visible, local assembly of believers who have been scripturally baptized and who gather together regularly for the purpose of carrying out the Great Commission. The church is described by several metaphors in the New Testament, including a body, a building, and a bride. However, none of the metaphors should be interpreted to preach that the church is a universal, invisible organism, which is what many teach. The church is a local, visible assembly. The origin of the Lord's church: Jesus Christ founded the church, not Peter, not the Pope, not someone who left Rome, but Jesus Christ himself. Having assembled and organized the first church during his earthly ministry, the foundation of this church was the apostles whom he called and trained. The first guidelines for church discipline were given during Jesus Christ's ministry. The ordinances of the church were given during Christ's ministry. The Great Commission was given to the church before the day of Pentecost. Those who were saved and baptized in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost were added to the church, which was already in existence at that point. The purpose of the church is to bring God glory, honor, and praise. In the process of bringing glory to God, I believe that the New Testament church has been given the job of fulfilling the Great Commission. The Great Commission involves three distinct areas of purpose and pursuit: preaching to the unsaved of all nations, baptizing those who become believers, and doing the work of discipleship, teaching them to observe all things. The Lord's church can be identified by several distinguishing marks. Number one is an acceptance of the Bible as the only authority and rule for all matters of faith and practice. Number two is a restriction of church membership to those who have a clear testimony of experiencing the new birth. Number three is a defense of the doctrine of baptism, that baptism is a biblical mandate for all believers and that it is the door of membership to the church. That baptism, we'll speak about in a little bit, defining exactly what that is. An acceptance, number four, of two church ordinances, baptism and the Lord's Supper, but a refusal to attribute to either of these any saving merit or extra grace. Number five, in these distinguishing marks, is a proclamation of the priesthood of every believer, such that no believer needs any other mediator than Christ to come into the very presence of God. We don't have to go through a man. Number six is a defense of soul liberty, whereby every believer is responsible to search the Word of God and base his belief solely upon the Scriptures. Seven, a maintenance of church purity through the mechanism of church discipline according to the guidelines of Scripture. Number eight, separation from error, unbelief, and compromise of the religious world. And number nine, a belief that each church is autonomous in its government and responsible before the Lord for their decisions. Speaking of the ordinances of the church, these two ordinances, baptism and the Lord's Supper, baptism has four distinguishing marks. The candidate for baptism, number one, should be one who is saved and has a valid salvation testimony of repentance from sin and faith toward the Lord Jesus Christ. Scriptural baptism is always and only by immersion, going fully under. The authority to baptize is vested in the New Testament church, not in an individual alone. It's only found in a church. And number four, the motive of baptism is to make a public statement of one's faith in Christ, to publicly picture the gospel of Christ, and then to be joined to that New Testament church. The Lord's Supper was first observed in the first church and has continued to be the practice of the church. It's intended to be kept in the church. I believe that the observance of the Lord's Supper is restricted to members of a particular New Testament Baptist church who are in fellowship with that church and submitted to the authority of that church. Amen. Specifically, like members of another Baptist church could not come in here to Lehigh Valley Baptist Church and participate in Lord's Supper with us. Not that we don't like them, but we don't know them. They're not part of this body, and it's limited only to this church. Amen. I believe that the observance, or that the elements to be used at the Lord's Supper consist of unleavened bread and unfermented wine, grape juice, as the absence of leaven and fermentation is metaphorical of the pure and sinless body and blood of Jesus Christ, which was given as the sacrifice for our sins. I believe that this ordinance is given to the church as a means of remembering the Lord's death until he comes for us. The offices of the Lord's church, there are two offices that have specifically been given to the New Testament church, that of the pastor and of the deacon. Both of these officers are to be chosen by the church membership, keeping in mind the qualifications in Scripture. Those are the qualifications that my dad spoke about this morning. They can be found in 1 Timothy 3, 1 through 7, and Titus chapter number 1, verses 6 through 9. The duties of a pastor are revealed in Scripture as, number one, an elder, that he's to rule the church. Number two, a bishop, that he is to oversee the church. Number three, as a pastor, he is to shepherd the church and protect the church from the grievous wolves that would seek to destroy the flock. And number four, that he is a preacher or teacher, that he is to instruct the church. The qualifications of a deacon can be found in 1 Timothy 3, 8 through 13. These men, as seen in Acts chapter number 6, are to be servants of the flock, not rulers over the flock. The polity of the Lord's church, or how it is to operate, the head of the Lord's of each New Testament church is the Lord Jesus. And thus a church should not be subject to any other organizations or entities. No ruling fellowships or anything like that. The church should be self-financing, supporting the work of God through the tithes and offerings of the members. The church has been given the authority to discipline its own members if necessary. The church is responsible to select its own officers, and the government of the church is theocratic in principle and democratic in practice. The will of the church should be subject to the will of Christ and respectful of the leadership and oversight of its pastor. The perpetuity of the Lord's church, I believe that since the inception of the first church established by Jesus Christ himself, there has always been at least one, and usually many more than one, New Testament churches functioning according to the pattern set forth in the Word of God. Jesus promised us that there would always be a true church until the time of the rapture, and I believe that Jesus keeps his promises. I believe that the true church of the Lord Jesus Christ are not those that identify themselves as having come out of Rome or Protestant. That's the word I was looking for earlier. Nor are they associated with the Roman church, but these true churches have always been distinct and set apart by a trail of bloody persecution which they have endured through history. I believe that the Lord's church should be separate as well, that it should remain separate from the world and be careful not to mingle in activities with those of other doctrinal persuasions. The church should be careful not to surrender her authority to parachurch organizations which may exercise control or influence over her. Amen. Concerning end times, I believe in and look forward to the fulfillment of the scriptural promise that Jesus Christ will return in like manner as he ascended. I believe that his return to this earth will be a bodily return, and that every eye will see him. I believe that this return will be preceded by the rapture of the saints and 7 years of tribulation upon this earth. And I believe that following this return, Jesus will set up an earthly kingdom where he will rule and reign for 1,000 years. At the end of this 1,000 years, Satan will be loosed and will incite people of the earth to rebel against God. At that time, Jesus will destroy his enemies and burn the heaven and earth with a fire, so that he can make a new heaven and new earth that will last for all of eternity. His return is promised. There's a clear biblical promise that Jesus will one day return to this earth in a literal bodily fashion, and that every eye will see him. The return of the Lord will be like a thief in the night, and it will catch everyone by surprise. His coming is imminent, and there is no way that you and I can know the exact timing. There are two parts of the Lord's return. The first part that's indicated in Scripture is the rapture, or the catching away of the saints, just before the beginning or commencement of the 7 years of tribulation. At this rapture, all believers will be caught up to the air to be with the Lord. And then the revelation, this is the literal bodily return of the Lord Jesus Christ to the earth. At this revelation, Jesus will return to the Mount of Olives, where he will be revealed in a bodily, visible and glorious manner before the eyes of the whole earth. He will be coming as judge to set up his kingdom for 1,000 years. I believe that the tribulation will last for seven years, and that the most intense suffering will be during the last half of the tribulation time, when God's wrath will be poured out upon this earth. These judgments are revealed in the book of Revelation. During this time of tribulation, the scriptures indicate that salvation will only be possible for those who have not previously heard and rejected the gospel message. Those that have heard will come under strong delusion. While this period of tribulation will be taking place on earth, the saved will be in heaven, appearing before the judgment seat of Christ, where their works will be tried by fire to determine their reward. The marriage supper of the Lamb will take place toward the end of the tribulation time, and at this marriage supper, there will be a bridegroom, Christ, and a bride, his church, and guests. The purpose of Christ's coming, when he comes, he will catch away all believers. When these believers are caught away, the resisting influence of the Holy Spirit will be removed from this world, and Satan will wreak havoc. He will resurrect all those who are dead. The bodies of those who are already dead will be resurrected at the time of the rapture. The bodies of Old Testament saints and saints killed during the tribulation will be resurrected after the tribulation, and the bodies of unbelievers will be resurrected to appear before the judge at the great white throne after the 1,000-year reign. He will set up then his millennial kingdom. This will be a literal 1,000-year reign of Jesus Christ upon the earth. His millennial kingdom will bring about the final completion of the Old Testament covenants with the nation of Israel. This will be a time of great peace upon the earth and enjoyment of the absence of curse of sin. Satan will be absent from this kingdom until the very end of the 1,000 years, where he will then be released from hell and will stir up people of the earth to new rebellion against Christ. After his final defeat, Satan will be cast into the lake of fire for all of eternity, upon which Jesus Christ will make a new heaven and a new earth. Concerning creation, I believe in the biblical account of creation. That is to say that God literally created all that is in 7 literal days. I believe that creation was perfect in its original state and that man was given the authority to have dominion over this creation for the glory of God. The meaning of creation, I believe that God created everything that is from nothing. In other words, he called into existence everything that exists by his own divine power. He is the creator of all. You and I, we have to create from things that already exist. We have to take lumber and other building materials and make something, but Jesus Christ spoke it into existence. As such, we see the fingerprints of the Creator upon his creation in the form of his masterful design, even though it is marred by sin. His method was the divine work. The Bible speaks of the moon and stars being the work of the fingers of God speaking the creation into existence. And as such, I reject the notion that God would have used the mechanisms of evolution to produce this world and all it is. Concerning human life, lastly, this afternoon, I believe that human life is very precious to God and that it ought to be precious to mankind. There are very strong admonitions in the Scripture against those who willfully take the life of another human being. And I believe that these admonitions have a bearing upon at least 2 current issues that confront us in this day and age. Regarding abortion, I believe that abortion is wrong and that it is a violation of the scriptural command, thou shalt not kill. I believe that human life begins at conception and that every life is precious to God, no matter how mankind may value or devalue that life. I therefore believe that abortion in all of its forms and with all of its justifications is condemned clearly by God. Regarding euthanasia as well, I believe then that the hastening on of death to forgo inconvenience on the part of some person or another is morally wrong. I believe that we are bound to protect the lives of those who are feeble and advanced and aged, and to allow God to choose the day of their death rather than hurrying that on. And I believe finally that it's wrong to enact euthanasia, even if the person in consideration has requested to die early. This would be synonymous with assisted suicide, in my opinion. And that's all we have. Hopefully you were able to stay awake. Can you imagine if we'd read all the verses that went along with that too?
He put Philip to sleep. Philip's out cold. All right, you've heard Samuel's doctrinal statement, and at this time I'd like to make a recommendation, a motion to the church that we would call for Samuel's ordination to the gospel ministry, recognizing the gifts and the calling of God upon his life, authorizing him officially for the work of the ministry, and sending him to that work at this time in Cabot, Arkansas. That's a motion. If we have one of our other men that would like to make a second, Brother Jonathan will take that. And then all the members of Lehigh Valley Baptist Church, if you're in favor with receiving that motion and you would like to agree with that, you can signify by raising your right hand if you're a voting member of Lehigh Valley Baptist Church. All right, you can put your hands down, and anyone who would be opposed, it would be the same sign. All right, so ordered. All right, very good. At this time, I'd like to invite our deacons and Pastor Gable, George, to come and join me on the platform. And these men are going to help me. We're going to pray together for Samuel, for his ministry, and ask the Lord to bless him. Some of the men are going to be praying specifically for him about some specific areas and committing him to the Lord in his work of the ministry. And so we invite you to join with us as we take this time to pray with and for him. Sam, why don't you come stand up here?
Heavenly Father, we have gathered here. I am rejoicing in my heart for this day. I'm so grateful that you have brought it to pass. We have waited patiently for you to bring the time, and now is the time. And Father, we are excited for the work that you're about to do through his life and through Meg's life. It is our prayer and our desire of you that you would give them and bring forth and bring across men for him to train as they seek to perform and fulfill the great commission you have commanded us. We thank you that the power to perform and do this great mission is not found within ourselves, but it is found in the Holy Scriptures, the very word of God, and we are grateful that it is the sword of the Spirit which does that work for us. I do pray as you bring forth men across this path and as he trains them, I pray that you would give them a burden for souls and that you would work in their hearts as they look on the harvest field that you've set before them, and it truly is white, and there are many that are dying right now, Lord, in desperate need to hear the gospel message that you have transformed our lives with. I pray that the church's burden for these souls would grow to a point in which they cannot hold their mouths silent, just as the disciples were given the Holy Ghost and they could not hold their tongues. They were going to obey your presence and your message, and they were going to obey your command that they would speak boldly for your name's sake. I pray that you would raise men up and use them to do this very thing. I pray you would give wisdom to my brother here as he seeks to minister and teach. I pray, as I've seen even with Pastor Jeff Goss and Pastor Thomas Anger, as you've sent off other men from this church, Lord, I've seen where they've taken the teachings that you've given them from here, and in those teachings, they've been able to minister to their congregation and teach those things to other men faithfully. I pray all the things that you have given. It is, as I meditate on this, Father, I look at the seeds of Doug Hammett that have been blossomed and are flourishing. And I see now another opportunity, Lord, for you to take the faithfulness of this man and spread it out into the other areas of this country in which we desperately need your light to shine. We ask your blessing upon him. We send him forth with our encouragement for him. And we ask that you would bless all the work that he does in your name. And we ask these things according to your will in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our Heavenly Father, this afternoon it is a great privilege to come to your throne together as a church. Father, we realize and we recognize that all of heaven, we believe this afternoon, is very aware of the activities taking place here in this moment. Father, because the work of planting churches and sending men to labor in the gospel ministry is the work that you've appointed to your church. We're blessed today to be a part of this, and thank you for my brother Sam. Thank you for how you've worked in his life. Thank you for your call, for his willingness to surrender to it, and to be willing to take his family now and to move from this place that he's called home and move to another location that you've directed their path to. I pray as they go that you would minister in a special way to him the grace that he's going to need to be able to minister to his family. Father, I know you've called him to pastor a church, to do the work of an evangelist, and you have a great job for him to do there, but I pray that you would help him in the midst of the work and the demands of the ministry, that you would give him the sustaining grace that he needs to be a husband and a father, and to minister to the needs of his family at home. I pray that he would be able to do this, and by your Spirit to be a pattern and an example to the believers in the church there in Cabot of a godly family, that you would give them your grace. We know it's only by your grace that godly families are brought forth. But Father, we understand the tremendous need for godly families, so many that need a pattern to follow that exemplify the biblical qualities of what a family ought to be. And I pray for Sam that as the head of his home, that you would give him the spirit of meekness to lead and a spirit of a gentle servant to be an example, not only in his home, but in the ministry, that you would enable him to be a protector of his family and to give them the spiritual direction that they need. I pray as their children come along and are raised up, that they'd be able to raise them in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, that he'd be able to comfort and help his wife and be all that he needs to be to her. There's a lot of changes that they're going to face in these days, especially as they go through this time of transition. And I pray that you would just give them your grace that would help them beyond what they are able, even in themselves. Give them your sustaining grace to make them able. I just pray for your hand of blessing and protection to be upon their family, because, Father, we know that the enemy loves to destroy families. And I pray that that would not be the case, but that you would put up a hedge of protection by your ministering spirits, the angels, that they would do the work that they can do, that, Father, you would enable this family to be a beacon of hope, to be a safe haven, that they would serve the Lord together, and that, God, you would just make their home a joyful place and a place that exemplifies all that you desire the family to be. We pray, Father, for your hand upon them as they go forward to this great work, and we thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to be a part of this today, and we look forward to what you'll do in the days ahead. In Jesus' name we pray.
Father, today I thank you for the privilege to be here and the privilege of our church. We thank you for the gift that you have given to us and another man called to the ministry and going to pursue your will for his life. Thank you for the years laboring together here at Lehigh Valley Baptist Church. And now I pray that you would help Brother Sam as he goes forward. Lord, as he has the responsibility, the heavy responsibility of taking your word and preaching it with authority and with power, we pray that you would help him, Lord, to study, to show himself approved as a workman of you. And Lord, I know that study is wearisome to the flesh. Study is something that the devil is going to insert busyness and distractions and try to pull Sam away from that. I pray that you'd help him to study, that he would preach the word. He'd be instant in season and out of season. I pray that you'd help him in Liberty Baptist Church to feed the flock of God over which you have made him the overseer. And I pray that he'd be diligent in, Lord, being in your word himself, in his walk with you, but then in his study, that he would be able to teach and to preach God's word, Lord, not just from the pulpit, Lord, but also in private, Lord, as he counsels and he evangelizes and helps people on a private level. I pray that you'd give him great wisdom and great skill in your word to be able to take the power and the principles that are found there and apply them to people's lives, that hearts and lives would be changed for your honor and glory. I pray that you would bless Sam and Meg and their family, help them in the days ahead, and may you bless their ministry, that Liberty Baptist Church would grow and thrive as the people there are fed the true word of God. Bless them as they go. Thank you for allowing us as a church the privilege to be involved in what you have done and what you're doing today. And we pray this in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Lord, we are grateful for this day, and Lord, for what you're doing in Sam's life. And Lord, we ask that you would empower him to be the man that he needs to be. I pray that his personal walk with you would be vibrant, and Lord, would be, Lord, faithful and consistent. Lord, as Lord, you deal with his heart. Lord, keep him humble. Lord, it's the only way that, Lord, you can use him fully, as if he's fully humbled and surrendered to you. And I pray that, Lord, that that would be the goal of his life. I pray that you would, Lord, help him to stand strong, when things get difficult, that, Lord, having done all that he would stand because he has the truth of the word of God, and Lord, that he would be faithful there and Lord, in his personal life, Lord, in seeking after you, Lord, in allowing you to work in his heart and his life on a daily basis and not be, Lord, distracted by needs of the ministry, but Lord, that you would empower him. And I pray that he would depend upon and would crave your Holy Spirit power in his life, and Lord, that he would be drawn closer to you and, Lord, have a deep and a vibrant relationship with you on a daily basis. And Lord, we know that he needs that so that you can use him fully. And so, Lord, we commit Sam and Meg and Ruby and, Lord, their family to you. And Lord, we just ask that you would go before them. We thank you. We love them. We thank you that you love them and you desire your best and, Lord, are sending them out. Lord, thank you for hearing our prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our Father, we stand in awe of who you are and what you've done. We recognize today that it is a tremendous work of grace when you call sinful men into the work of the ministry and give spiritual gifts to men so that they can represent you and shepherd a flock. Pray this afternoon for Sam. I just pray that your hand would be upon him in a very special way. I pray that he would be aware of your presence. I pray that you would walk with him and he would walk with you and fellowship with you. Father, I pray that you would give him wisdom to deal with the many challenges that are ahead. We know that the work of the ministry is not an easy work, and it is a work. And so I pray that you would give him the strength, the courage, and the help that he needs as he walks this road, not knowing all that is ahead. I pray for the church there in Cabot, and I pray for the transition as Brother Neesmith steps down, and as Sam takes over that work, I pray that you would enable that church family to come successfully through the transition of leadership. I pray, Father, that you would encourage them for the days ahead. And then I pray that you would give them a vision for reaching out with the gospel to the area where you have placed them to be a lighthouse. We know that ministry in the Bible Belt is very different from ministry here in this part of the country. And so I pray that you'd give them creativity and wisdom and help, and especially help Sam as he leads the church in these things. Now, Father, as pastor of Lehigh Valley Baptist Church, I want to thank you for the privilege that we have to be a part of this today. Thank you for putting your hand on men in our congregation and calling them to preach. Thank you for sending. And Lord, we know that we have a function in sending, but ultimately it's the Holy Spirit who sends. And we're just grateful, Heavenly Father, that you've allowed us to have a part of this. I pray that you would witness these proceedings, that your smile of blessing would be upon these proceedings, and that Sam and Meg, as they leave tomorrow to go to Arkansas, would go with the blessing of this church and the blessing of God upon their life. We thank you and praise you. We worship you that we can be a part of this today, and we ask and pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 If you men want to come by and congratulate Sam on your way off the platform, and then I've got a couple of things. Congratulations. Certificate of ordination here, signed by the men.
today and commemorating this event. And then I also have a Bible to commemorate this event from the church. And Allison is going to come. Meg, would you come? We have some flowers for you. And then we have some notes from the church family as well for you to take with you. So. All right, so we're going to have them come down front here in just a minute. And I know many of you would like to come by and say goodbye to them. They are leaving first thing in the morning to start the long trek to Arkansas. It's a long drive, especially in a 26-foot moving truck. So you pray for them over the next couple of days as they're traveling. And I know we have plenty of time for folks to come by and say goodbye to them. We're not having an evening service tonight, so if you come back at 6, there may still be some people here, but we're not planning to have a service. We're glad that each of you are here. One more item of business that we wanted to talk about, and I've spoken with the men about this. The church down in Cabot at one time was completely self-supporting, and in the last couple of years, they've gone through some hard circumstances. And they've lost some of their membership, and the church has struggled somewhat financially. Brother Neesmith, who has pastored down there faithfully for the last 12 years, has been bivocational pretty much the whole time, although the church had gotten to a place where they could have supported him fully. But the church is no longer in a position to be able to support a pastor fully financially at this point. And obviously, Sam is going to have a need to be bivocational. He's already started working on that, at least for the time being. But the men felt like it would be wise for us as a church to help with that. And I believe that would be what God would want us to do in this situation. So the men are recommending that we would support from our missions program like we are doing with Brother Thomas Anger, actually a very similar situation, and that we would make a commitment at least for the next year and a half, which would be our church budget is at the beginning of August, so we would be making a commitment from now till August, and then it would be included in the church budget again this coming fiscal year, so at least for that long, and to be reconsidered at that point of supporting Sam and Meg for $1,000 a month, and we would send that directly to the church there for them to help with their financial needs, and that would give them some space and time to figure out where he's going to work and what kind of other work he could do, which would have the minimum impact on him being able to be involved in the ministry. And so we'd like to do that. That's a motion from our men. If there's someone who would like to make a second in regards to that, all right, Matt, we'll take that. And all those in favor of seeing us take that step of supporting them, just signify by raising your right hand. All right, you can put your hands down, and anyone that would be opposed to that would be the same sign as well. All right, amen. So ordered. All right, so we're going to be dismissed at this time. We're going to ask Sam and Meg to just come down here in the front. We can make a line going up this direction, and folks can come by and say goodbye to them and let them know of your love and prayers for them at this time. Thank you so much for being a part of the day today. It's been a blessing. I do believe that there's quite a bit of soup left out there, and there may be boxes of sandwiches going home with people as well, if you can help us with that. I think Brother Fetterman has some things. Please, if you brought a pot of soup, don't leave it here for us. We don't want to eat it tomorrow or later this week for lunch. Please take it home with you. And there's no one planning to do the dishes here this afternoon either. So you can help us out with that by taking your pot of soup home. But thank you to those of you who shared in that. Don't forget, Wednesday night, 7 p.m., we start our missions conference with Pastor Tony Skeving. We hope that you'll plan to be here Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. We're not going to have our normal prayer meeting. It's going to be our missions conference. And then
Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, our goal is we'll have a missionary phone call, one or two songs, and then we'll have Brother Skeving up to preach so that we can keep the service to a manageable time. We know many of you have your children in school and need to get home, don't want to be out late, so we're going to do our best to honor that and get Brother Skeving up here preaching so that the services will be done in a timely fashion. Thank you so much for being here today. You are dismissed.